7:30, so we're going to call the meeting to order, and the first order of business is to review and approve, hopefully, the minutes of January 18th. Did everybody get a chance to take a look at the draft minutes?
Yes, a couple of minor.
A couple of minor, okay. Why don't you go through them, what you got?
Under new business, the fat paragraph there. In the middle, the agenda close date will now be 14 days prior instead of none.
Okay.
Oh, and I'm sorry, right before that, meetings should be meeting. A special meeting may be scheduled. The first line.
Yep.
And then on the last page, first full paragraph. Bottom line, no changes have been made to the application, and it was resubmitted. That's all I got.
Okay.
Top of page two, first sentence, I think, right where Dave recused himself instead of abstained.
Oh, you abstained yourself.
I didn't read that one because I recused myself.
Did I do it again?
Top, yeah, page two, very first line. Recused, Dave Tobias recused himself from the case. Yep. That's all I saw.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anybody have anything else?
Nope.
Tim?
No.
Okay. With those corrections, I'll make a motion to accept the minutes from January 18th. Do I have a second?
Yeah, I'll second it.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, carried. And the first piece of new business is the application on the Eveready Diner. And since my law firm represents them, I'm going to have to recuse myself. So, Jeff, would you be kind enough to take us through it?
Okay.
Good evening. Brian Watts from MAJ Engineering here on behalf of the applicant.
We have authorization for you to represent the applicant.
Okay. This notice has been submitted prior. So our office.
Is this the this one?
The Nicholas.
Yep. Certification this.
Yeah.
I got this. Yep. Okay.
Good.
So it says MAJ Engineering. Okay.
Yep.
Go ahead.
The applicant is seeking to have some variances that were previously approved on September 29th, 2015, reapproved. They expired while we were waiting for some documentation relating to a consolidation deed to have the subdivision signed and sealed and submitted. Those specific variances were related to the setbacks for the building located in the rear or in the front, the front yard setback, and the total lot coverage. The application has not changed at all since the prior approval.
So these are two variances that would be required on the combined parcels after
Correct.
The lots are all combined.
Correct.
So John, that's a little unusual for us. So we'd be combining, we'd be considering area variances for a combined lot which doesn't exist right now. Because it's, I guess the situation is there are three lots in the town.
Correct.
And they, as they stand now, they have multiple non-conformances with the zoning law. But your plan is to combine those three lots into one.
That is correct.
Which then reduces the number of non-conformances just down to two.
Correct.
Okay, so I think that what we'll need to do is at the time that you if you should decide to grant the variances, that they be conditioned upon, you know, the granting of the variances conditioned upon the merger of the prospective merger of the lots.
Okay.
As represented by the applicant during the review.
Okay.
Jeff, speaking of Rich's point, do you want to assign this project now?
Yeah, maybe I can all take it. You're doing one just now, right? You did one recently?
Not for about 2 months.
The subdivision has been back before the board and has preliminary approval again.
Okay.
That is current.
All right. Then again,
just out of curiosity, is the merger of the lots, that's what the applicant wanted, or was that requested by the
planning? I believe that was requested by the town.
The town?
By Ron.
Okay.
Due to the nonconformities, that would reduce, I believe it has 9 right now, and they would reduce it from 9 to 2. And the applicant has no issue doing that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so let's see. We got, and on that subject, Richard, I just realized I'm not going to be here at the March 15th meeting, so that would be when the public hearing would be if we accept the application.
Okay.
So
we're good. I can do it, or David. Or
anybody else? You've seen yard.
I got it. Good.
Okay. All right. Sorry about that.
No problem.
Okay. So all right, let's see.
That March 15th? Did we say it was the?
Yeah, we haven't decided on that yet.
Okay.
Hold on a second.
I have a question for John. Again, this was the restaurant that burned down. What is that non-conforming use lost? I should know the answer to this, but I don't. Is it lost because it burned down? I mean, the front yard, the side yard, with the existing structure. I don't think so. I don't know.
I don't know the answer to that without looking at
yep.
the grant
yep.
of the variance.
Because I'm wondering. All right. Okay. Proceed.
I'll be honest with you. I did not have a chance to. Ron's denial letter on this, I think, just came in
yeah,
today.
It did. Yep.
I didn't have a chance to
right.
look at it. But that's a good question.
Okay. Thank you.
How long ago did it burn? Was it 4 years?
I don't recall, to be honest.
Okay. On the survey, it says this portion of the building to be removed, but I don't see an arrow.
It is the banquet area that was off the side of the building. I believe that you're not planning on rebuilding that portion.
So it's that
the
striped area, north-south.
North-south, yes,
okay.
Correct.
So if you maybe come over here and just show me. So there's this lot here, correct?
This is one lot. It's located here. One lot here.
And this is the third one.
Yes, 3 is here.
And then the large one.
And the large.
So there's
one
4 lots.
Hold back here.
And you're going to combine all 5?
They're going to remove this lot line, and this lot line.
Okay, so you're going to combine, this is a lot, this is a lot, this is a lot, and this is a lot. Right?
1, 2, 3, 4 lots.
4, yeah.
And you're going to move the internal lot lines.
Yeah, parcels 1 and 2, 3 and 4. This doesn't make any sense at all. Yeah. That's
peculiar how it was.
Yep. And this is the town-village line right here.
Correct.
So it only corners it. Okay, I understand. And you said you've been in front of the planning board?
Yes, we have, for the subdivision.
Okay. And I'm sorry, while you're here, just really quickly point to 2 remaining variances needed.
The front yard setback
okay.
is 39.
It's required to be 60. Right there.
Right here. And the total coverage, maximum coverage is 10%.
Right,
16%.
Right, okay.
Did they address seeker, you know?
The site plan, before they can go with the site plan approval, they have to have subdivision approval. Subdivision has preliminary approval. At this point, it is conditional upon the variances, the consolidation deed, which I believe has been resubmitted, and they currently do have a plat and plans waiting to be signed. They're just waiting on the consolidation deed. And then this expired while we were waiting for the consolidation deed.
I would imagine they would take the agency, wouldn't they?
I think it sounds to me like SECR's already done, because they would not be able to issue preliminary approval without having completed that. And in addition to that, for the purposes of our work, this can probably be classified as a type 2 action.
Okay.
Anyway.
Even if there was a SECR done overall, we have to make a decision?
Well, I think that we will make a note in the minutes that we'll verify with the planning board that SECR's been completed.
All right.
And then if not, then we will classify the action at the next meeting.
Okay.
And the first variance, the frontage, is essentially a reestablishment of what was there.
Correct.
Anybody else have any questions?
John, do we need to go through the, sample resolution? The consideration factors?
Well, I think it's premature to do to get to the considerations at the moment.
Okay.
However, I think that the template is good for giving us some guidance in that section ZBA review as to what has to be done tonight. You can deem the application complete this evening if you wish. SECR, we're not going to take any steps on that this evening until we can verify that the planning board has handled SECR. And if that's the case, Richard, I'll give you some language that can be substituted into that section. This does require a referral to the Dutchess County Planning Department.
Got it. Mm-hmm.
This does require referral to the Town of Rhinebeck Planning Board. And it does not require referral to either the CAB or the Waterfront Advisory Committee.
Because it's not in the LWRP.
It's not in the LWRP for the WAC, and it's not involving the development of open land for the CAB.
Okay. Does the village have a separate planning board?
Yes.
Does it have to go there?
I think that we'll need to... Well, you're not really doing anything new in the village, right? You're not changing the parking lot?
No, we're not.
But actually, I don't think you'll be able to merge the village parcel, and there should be a village tax lot, with the town tax lot. So I think you're going to end up with two lots.
I'm not 100% sure of that process.
I mean,
the surveyor.
There are parcels that cross municipal boundary lines.
Okay, my understanding is that there aren't. I mean, that municipalities really try hard to avoid
yes,
that.
Yes, they do. They do.
So maybe it's not the case here, but it would be really...
It's a question to raise to the planning board if that hasn't been something that's been discussed already. Has the village had any participation in the subdivision?
To my knowledge, no, that they decided not to.
And then didn't show.
With the town, yes.
Yeah.
I mean, it gets very difficult for municipalities to do property taxes when there's one lot that straddles a line. So I think, you should definitely pursue that question, it looks like, because a lot of the property line actually runs along the town and village, but then you get into the parking area, and it looks like there's a question about whether there were, it looks like there aren't existing tax lots separate from town and village, which is really strange. I don't remember ever seeing that before. So anyway, you'll check that out, I guess. I have one question about the 12 parking spaces. It looks like it's over, you have parking over an SDS area. That's not usual either, because of course, am I reading that wrong?
What are we?
specifically?
So you see the rectangle that says 12 parking spaces? Yeah. And then it seems to be sitting on...
That's just an overwrite.
It's an overwrite.
I believe that's just overwrite, that it's referring to...
It says approximate SDS area.
Is this property not on the, not connected to the village sewer system?
No, it has private water and septic.
There's another one here.
They're not hooked onto the water line either, the one that goes...
Oh, you know what, this is...
Is that a mistake?
That might be a mistake, I'll double check.
You want to do that, because it doesn't, again, you don't usually see parking areas over septic fields.
Correct, you're right. I don't believe they have intention to do that. I will double check.
Check that.
So there's another one out here, I don't know, maybe, is it getting moved?
No, they're reusing it existing, they inspected it and with the Board of Health.
So is this second one an expansion area, or...
I would have to double check the records and make sure that wasn't an overwrite or a mistake.
Okay, any other questions from you guys about this? It looks complete to me, so it's a motion to accept the application.
Second.
Second, anybody else? You feel?
Yes, I'm in.
Vote, yes, no?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, so we vote to accept the application. So we'll schedule a public hearing for the next meeting, which is March 15th.
15th.
I will not be here. Richard and you, but we can take it, so you can probably move it tomorrow, next week, next time.
Yep.
And we'll look into SEACER, see what the planning board did, and we'll defer a decision on SEACER until the public hearing.
And you have to give Chris time for the public hearing, so she can do the notice.
Okay, it'll be the first one of the evening. Do we have any new cases? I guess we don't know that yet, do we? We want to make it 7:45, which is what we did for the first public hearing this tonight?
Sure.
Okay.
And Chris, a notice should be sent to the village of Rhinebeck as part of, mail a public notice to them. And then you should also direct Chris to refer the application to Dutch County Planning Department and the Rhinebeck, I know the Rhinebeck Planning Board's a formality, because it's already there.
Got that, Chris?
Yes.
Please notify Dutchess County Planning and the Rhinebeck Planning Board.
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, we're done.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
I just need a minute to catch up.
Okay.
Actually...
Looks like you're excused.
Yeah, looks like I'm excused, I can finish writing elsewhere.
Going rogue, you ready?
No.
Okay, next is the Lions application, and Mark, you're going to present?
Yes, I am.
Okay, just keep your voice up so they can get you on the film. Good? Okay.
Good evening, I'm Mark Kaminsky, representing John Lyons on an application for... Actually, the application has come from the planning board for a home occupation class two. John's property is located on the west side of Morton Road. It is, parcel size is a little more than 8.5 acres. It is also it's the location of John's residence. So if you look at the plans, Morton Road located on the right-hand side of the map is a driveway that enters into the property, and it There's a parking area in front of a garage. That's labeled as two-story frame structure, and then adjacent to that is John's residence. So initially, an application was made to the planning board for the home occupation, so it included that application for a special permit and then others that were required by the planning board. In going through that application with the planning board, it was discovered that there was a determination made that in order for this special permit process to move on, that there's a section of the code that refers to the lot needing to be of adequate acreage in order to grant that permit. And so that's what led to, so then this application has been tabled with the planning board, and we are now in front of the ZBA for a request of an area variance for the lot size in order to continue through with the application for the home occupation class 2. And that home occupation is going to be located, I don't know if if this board would like me to go through the planning board application.
Just briefly tell us, you know, where the use is going to be. And I mean, I understand it's supposed to be a 20-acre lot. It's an 8-acre lot, and that's why we're here.
That's why we're here. And that's, so it's just simply John's going to locate his office in the second story of the garage.
Okay.
So that's listed as a two-story structure. And so we meet all the criteria in order to allow that home occupation. It's defined, and that use is defined as home occupation.
It's available.
It is allowable, and it's a home occupation class 2. And so the only item, and so the public, you know, application was submitted to the planning board, accepted, public hearing was scheduled, it was advertised. Since it's on a county highway, notice was sent to county planning. The same thing, it's located in the LWRP because obviously it's, you know, adjacent to the Hudson River. So it has gone through those various advertisements and review by the planning board. And then this one item is that the acreage is not, it does not conform to the current zone. And so when the lot was created, it actually did. It was due to the zoning change. This lot was created, I believe it was 1995. And I have I submitted all that background information to the planning board. There's a various subdivision map. There's lot line alterations that took place prior to the zoning being changed in 2010. And so, this is an existing lot. It was prior to the new zoning change, and so that was at the time that was the only request that was being made to this board for area variance for lot size. Also, I just received a letter from Ron Evangelista today. It's actually dated the 14th with some other items that Ron also included for consideration for this board for variances. And I had a conversation with Ron this afternoon just to go over the letter. And so based on my conversation with Ron, obviously item number 2, and does the entire board have Ron's letter? It's dated February 14th.
Yes.
So item 2 is what we applied for is for a variance from the 8.5 acre lot size versus the 20 as required by the zoning ordinance. Number 1 basically speaks to
setback
issues that were pre-existing to this application. And so, and Ron has, in my conversation with Ron, it's to this board's discretion whether or not those variances are to be considered as part of this application, since I know there's, you know, been a change in how these are viewed and whether or not they're, you know, considered pre-existing and grandfathered. So Ron just put that in there for the board's consideration.
And the same thing with regard to number three.
Yeah, and with regard to number three, it's because there's an accessory structure right here. It's a storage building that John has on his property. So that's labeled storage, and I've labeled it. And that was actually an action that was considered by this board in 2013. John applied to the ZBA for relaxation, and it was aggregate size of accessory structures on the property, and that area of variance was granted. There was, at that time, there was no mention or requirement or application for that accessory structure to be also included in a variance, since it is in the front yard. It's in front of the principal dwelling. So that's also for consideration of this board, since it's a pre-existing condition.
I don't know if it makes any difference, but just a detail. Under the proposed accessory structure details, the footprint is listed as 1920. Shouldn't it be 960, since it's a two-story structure? Or am I using an out-of-date version of footprint?
I guess it should be, instead of footprint, it should say...
Total area.
Total area,
yeah,
correct.
One or the other.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Oh, really? 960 square feet is the square footage of the second floor.
Right, but John, I have a summary of for both floors.
Gotcha.
And that's where I refer to it as footprint. So gotcha. I think I was incorrect with that.
What can you just quickly describe what the conservation easement is up front? Or is that a utility easement?
No, it was a conservation easement it was 100 foot. It was part of the original subdivision that was done along that section of Morton Road. So that was included on the original subdivision.
Oh, do you know who owns that?
Sina Cutson.
It just goes 50 feet in.
It says 100.
The property is to preserve the...
frontage.
Morton Road at the point where the driveways meet the road.
Mark, you said, and I kind of remember it, but there was a prior application before this board on this property.
Right.
And when was that approximately?
I have a copy of it, Scott. It was 2013.
Okay. Maybe, Chris, if you can dig into the archives, it might be helpful just to have that prior. Can we have that?
You can have
okay,
that.
Great. Just to see what we did back then. So basically, it's your position that really all we need to consider is the substandard lot size.
It is.
Okay. The setbacks are something that probably don't need our attention based upon the change in the zoning law from last year, actually.
Yes, it was. That's right. The other change, June or July,
right,
2016, there was an amendment to the zoning.
Right, where we tried to take care of these pre-existing things.
Correct.
And not have to deal with them. Okay.
You want to assign this one, Scott?
Yeah.
I'm happy to.
I was just going to suggest
point
it to
out.
You. Exactly.
Preemptive.
All righty, and there's not going to be any change to the structures.
No change to the structure at all, and actually no change to any of the utilities. It's just the water supply will serve both structures, and the existing sanitary facilities are adequate for both structures. It would just be a connection, there's an existing tank. It's just a new sewer line connection to the existing tank, that's it.
Okay.
Does it make any difference if it's used as a dwelling?
We have to.
Oh, yeah, we can consider that. I think it's just
now?
Really the one thing.
Yeah.
But
so that there was that. So in other words, You're saying that the upper floor would be considered a dwelling?
Yeah, because it's listed as an accessory dwelling unit under the home office, presumably as an alternative.
Right, and so that alternative was discussed with the planning board, and so the determination was that you can only apply for one at a time. And so it was John's intention to, be an office, and there, in that office, there's going to be, bathroom cooking facilities. Just to be known that in the future, it could become an accessory structure with a dwelling unit. But that's not the specific application. This application is for John's office, law office, and for a home occupation class two.
The two-story frame structure, is it finished at this point in time?
It is. It's actually, it's finished on the lower floor is a garage, upper floor is finished, but it will require some additional remodeling in order to accommodate the law office.
But the outside structure remains
the outside structure is complete. It's okay. Finished.
I seem to recall one window was being enlarged or something like that. Yeah.
Anybody have any other questions about the application? Okay, David, you've been kind enough to shepherd this for the resolution, and we do have to make a secret determination. And
referrals.
And referrals.
Without John's help.
Without John's help. But I do have a cheat sheet here. The source will be unknown. Actually, taking a look at this, I think it's a type 2. 617, was it 5C10? Would you like to? Why don't you check it, since you're the engineer? I think referral to certainly the planning board has to be done. Dutchess County Planning, because there's a county road. And there's also, I have another indication here that there's a farm operation in an ag district, but the county road itself, I think, is going to bring in Dutchess County Planning. It's also, the property itself, I think, is pretty close to the water.
It is.
So it's within the LWRP coastal zone, so a referral has to be made out to the Waterfront Advisory.
And Chris, do you take care of these, or do we do these ourselves?
No, she does it. She does it. Yes.
I'm gonna say I think I do that.
You're gonna do the referrals,
done it yet, but yes.
Right? Yeah, and you have the form for that. Yeah. So I would just follow the forms we've had in the past for, because
yes,
we've definitely done it to Dutchess County. Obviously, the planning board. We have made a referral to the waterfront folks, and the CAC probably doesn't come into play because there's not any development of open space or open land. So they probably would not be a referral.
The CA, this is in the LWRP,
mm-hmm,
which means it does have to go to the CAB.
CAB, yeah. Okay.
WAC.
And WAC, yeah.
No, not CAB.
Not the CAB.
CAC?
WAC.
WAC, Waterfront Advisory.
Yes, referral to the Waterfront Advisory Committee. No referral to the Conservation Advisory Board.
Okay.
Got it.
It's like God spoke to us.
Not someone who was accused. And this is just for the single issue. It seems a little overreaching, doesn't it?
I think the number one and number three probably do not apply. I think we can continue. We can keep it in our minds, and we can change that. But I think, basically, we're just dealing with the substandard lot issue.
Right. Yeah. And I think it's 13.
Okay.
On type two.
So
it's 10 is for minor construction of minor accessory structures, and we're not building anything here.
So what's the full
construction
type
inside,
two?
Yeah.
Or makes type 2 section 13, is that what you're calling it?
I think so. Which is a granting of area variance, and that's what this is for
single family, two family, or three family residence.
Single family residence. A lot.
Right.
Okay.
We can also check
10 and 13.
Yes, we can do 10 and 13. That covers it all. And maybe what we can do is have Art Broad take a quick look at it too.
Construction and expansion of minor accessory structure. So, maybe it does 10. Let's say 10 and 13.
10 and 13 covers it.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, and I think that's all we have to do, other than make a motion. Yeah. Yeah, let's first apply the...
The application.
The application. I think it's complete. I'll make a motion to accept it as complete.
I'll second it.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, and then I'll make a motion that this is a type 2 action under SEAKER, under 617, 5C10, and 13 for good measure. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. I guess we'll put this on for...
315?
315, yeah. Now, I'm going to have a problem on... I may have a problem on 315. I may be on trial. I may not be here, so... but there'll be three. So we can... We have a quorum, and we can go forward. Everybody else going to be here?
Yeah.
God willing? Okay, good. Thanks, Mark.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Looks like McNown is up next.
Alright, this is ZBA case number 943, in the matter of the area variance application of Jonathan McKee. We're going to continue to read these, all right?
Yeah.
The applicant appellant is Jonathan McKean, referred to here after the applicant this appeal derives from the town of Rhinebeck building inspector's denial dated November 14, 2016. Property involved, 664 River Road in Rhinebeck. Tax parcel number is listed. And the property is 83.56 acres in the HP20 zoning district. The applicant is represented before this board by Jonathan Hoover of his firm, located in Brooklyn at 242 Third Street. The description of the proposed project, the appellant's project, is described as follows. Proposal to demolish an existing non-functional, non-historic garage, construct a new garage, and relocate an emergency generator and construct a new workshop building. Two area variances are required. The first area variance sought by the applicant is a front yard setback for the garage in HP 20 zoning district. It's 20-foot requirement pursuant to section 12521. However, the proposed setback for the new garage is 141 feet. So there's a variance required of 59 feet for the setback for the garage. Two, the second area variance sought by the applicant is a front yard setback for the workshop. Again, 200 feet required, and it's 190 feet, so that leaves a variance of 10 feet for the workshop. The third area variance was sought by the applicant regarding the number of accessory structures permitted in the HP 20 zoning district. However, in an email to the ZBA by the CEO dated the 21st of last year and confirmed by the town attorney, it was determined that the generator was less than the 50 square feet in size. Therefore, no variance would be required. Timeliness of the appeal. The appellant filed the appeal on 27, 2016, paid the requisite fees. It was filed within 60 days on November 14th, and thus it is timely. On the 21st of December, the board deemed the application complete and accepted it for review. SECRA, after accepting the appeal, we determined this matter should be classified as a type 2 action under the State Environmental Quality Review Act. And the specific sections, construction, expansion, replacement of minor accessory apartment residential structures, which is 617, 5C, and 10. Also, granting of individual setbacks and lot line variances, 617, 5C, 12. Referrals that the Rhinebeck Planning Board, as required by 125-125E of the town of Rhinebeck, it was referred to the Rhinebeck Planning Board. On the 12th day of December 2016, they did respond on the 22nd of December, comment of no planning or environmental concern. In effect, the application was referred to Dutchess County Planning Board on the 17th of November, and they responded on the 28th of November, no comments, matter of local concern. The application was sent to CAB WAC on December 12th, and they responded on the 21st of December. The CAB and WAC, after reviewing the submitted application and reviewing previous applications by the same applicant, this board upholds the decision. The request for area variance does not cause an issue with the environmental policies or the LWRP policies. In chapters 1, 2, 5, and 9, this application was also sent to the town of Red Hook as a courtesy on the 19th of January of this year because it is located within 500 feet of this border. No response has been received to date. Site visit, several ZBA members visited the applicant's property and the surrounding neighborhood. Site visit was conducted solely to gather information and guide the board's decision. Public hearing held on January 18th. During the course of the public hearing, we received no comments. Notice of the public was also sent to the town of Red Hook, and the public hearing was closed on February 15th of this year. Consideration of the five factors in the balancing test, which are required by 125-124C1 of the Rhinebeck zoning law. A, if the variances are granted, will they cause an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood or cause a detriment to the nearby properties? We feel the answer to this question is no. Second, can the benefits sought by the appellant be achieved by some method feasibly for the appellant or other than the variances proposed? We find the answer to this question is no. C, are the requested area variances substantial? We find the answer to this question is also no. Will the proposed variance have an adverse impact on the physical or environmental condition in the neighborhood or district? And a third, no. It is alleged difficulty self-created. On this, we found yes. The balancing act and the results, based on our analysis of the five factors discussed, we find that the balancing test favors granting of the area variances. So it now therefore be resolved based on the facts described above. One, the ZBA hereby grants the variances from zoning 12521, area variance number one, which is the setback requiring 200 feet. However, there was only 141, leaving a variance of 59 feet. And the second similar variance, but this one, that one was for the garage, this one's for the workshop, 200 feet. They have 190, so the variance is for 10. Section three, they are expressly contingent upon the planning board's approval, including site plan approval and special use permits for the workshop. The granting of these variances shall preclude and prohibit any further variances from being granted under the zoning law 12569C7 for this property for so long as the 2,300 square foot maximum gross floor area in that section of the law is in force in effect. The granting of these variants does not absolve the applicant from having to secure any other required permits or approvals, and the structures must be constructed in conformity with the application and plan submitted. The area variances shall be null and void unless the construction of this project is commenced within 1 year of its resolution, and the conditions sections 3-5 are met. I make a motion to approve this resolution. Well, okay. Do you want to discuss it first?
Well, actually, even before you put the motion to the floor, you need to open the public hearing. I know, unless Ed is here for the public hearing, there isn't anybody here. But if you recall, we did continue the public hearing over to tonight. Chris sent notice out
to
the town of Red Hook.
Yep.
So we should open the public hearing. If there's no one here, it can be, and then you can move on to consideration of the resolution.
So I'll open the public hearing. And is there anyone here who wishes to comment on this application?
Thank you. I did very little. Thank Ed, or thank Richard.
Say correct.
All right, so at this time, I'll entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? All right. I just had a couple of questions, and one of them was on the last section, John, section four.
Yes.
Is that required? And if so, why?
Yeah, I agree.
I mean, I think it was just taken from a form that you supplied to us, but I don't know if it applies. And I actually took it out of the resolution that I drafted, but.
I don't, you know, that got carried over, I think, from your other form. But it doesn't, I'd have to check section 125-69. I don't know what that.
I think you did a nice job, by the way.
I don't know what limit it's referring to.
That section could really cause a problem because the applicant wouldn't know, we wouldn't know.
Yeah.
And then if.
I just thought it was carried over from another form, and I just wasn't sure. And I took it out of the one.
I'd like to take it out of this, yeah. Too.
Yeah, and if the limitation exists in the law, in that section of the law, it doesn't need to be in the decision because
right.
The limitation's already in the law. So.
Good.
I think it's okay to take that out.
Okay.
I have a comment.
So that section of the law says, the maximum gross floor area of a principal structure within the RC-O district shall be no more than 2,300 square feet.
Okay, but it's not really clear from that. I think it's a stretch to be saying what's being said in that section four, because I'm not sure if it's correct.
Yeah.
I just don't know. I don't think we need it. That's
it'll be up to the zoning enforcement officer to, you know, if this party comes in again seeking a further variance to
deal with.
Figure out the answer to that question.
Is that okay to move that?
Yep.
Yes, it is. Yep.
Thank you.
And this may just be a matter of style, and I probably did it wrong, and it kind of gets into what I did on the findings of fact and conclusions of law. I just didn't say A, B, C, D, no. I kind of put a little bit more. I don't know if we should or not.
I think the more that you can put in, the more explanation that you can put in, the better. I mean, that doesn't mean.
I'm not saying this is wrong. I'm just saying it. I mean.
Well, I wouldn't say this would be considered a best practice. This would not be considered a best practice, just to be answering yes or no.
Because, do you quarrel with accepting it the way it is? Because,
well, if you want to put some extra, you know, even a few sentences that just explain, think of it this way, that if somebody were to be reviewing your decision, some explanation would provide them with an insight into why you said no or yes in answer to those questions. That's what you're really after.
I agree. And after we do this, then we should talk about drafting these, because it's going to be a burden on the members of the ZBA to draft these. I'm an attorney, and this was like, I was maxed out to do this.
I got to tell you, my paralegal, who is excellent, you know, she got it this afternoon, and I didn't give her the time she needed, but it's hard for somebody who's very versed in doing documents.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Let alone us.
Yeah.
You know, but I'm just talking about paralegals even. It was.
But, you know, the other thing I thought of is Chris would have to take incredible notes on everything we say, but I even if she did that, what is important, you know, and then one member gets to decide that.
Well, I think that's something that you might have to change going forward. I think that what needs to happen when you get to these criteria, when you're having a discussion, deliberations about whether you're going to grant the variance, that's the time when the members of the board ought to be some agreement amongst the majority needs to be reached for a brief explanation as underneath each one of these factors.
So we should do that after we close the public hearing, and before the resolution is presented at the next meeting, we discuss it.
That's right. So that when you're drafting the decision, you shouldn't have to do anything in the way of adding your own opinion. In other words, when that public hearing gets closed and the discussion is had, the person who ends up with the job of putting the board's decision on paper ought to have everything that they need to fill in the blanks in the decision.
So in our discussion afterwards, before the resolution is drafted, we have to tell that person, here's what we think ought to be put into these.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. All right.
Yeah. And it's just something, you'll find, I think, that after you're doing this for a little while, it'll just be a habit to look at every application through the prism of that balancing test. It's the most important, it's actually the most important thing that you guys do. If your decision is subject to a legal challenge, we have all the other procedural things laid out in this decision, but the guts of what a court is going to turn to look at is going to be item 14. Mm-hmm. And the case will live or die on the sufficiency of that section. Because you guys probably know this already, but the decision has to be rational and reasonable, based on evidence in the record, and the board has to present a reasoned elaboration for the basis for its decision.
So I'm not sure we've done that. Right in our first go-round here, I think Richard's fine draft otherwise just says, we deem no.
We deem.
Or we deem yes. But it's not elaborated. So we probably need to beef that up.
So for instance, on this,
John, if we were not on video camera, I would tell a little story. I'm going to tell it anyway, just like a second. My brother, my wonderful brother, straight A's his whole life, grammar school, high school, and not myself. And he said to me one day, he said, you know, Richard, to get straight A's, to get a 91 or an 88, you have a unit of effort. You go from 0 to 88. He said to go from 88 to 92, you have to double that unit of effort, which is what he did, which I did not do. So that is part of my difference with, and I defer to you as being doing a great, great job. And I will attempt to do that, but you're taking it to a necessary place, but it's going to be a burden on the members of the board.
Well, okay, so what I want to say is that I think that if this is done right, and the way that it was intended is that it's not supposed to be a burden, it's actually, it should be, I mean, the idea behind the template was to make it easy, okay? I think part of the burden is going to be changing the board's practice in terms of the steps that you follow leading up to a decision.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
So let me just give you an example. So if the variances are granted, will they cause an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood? Application like this, you may want to say that the changes that are being permitted by this variance are relatively small in scale, and the buildings blend in with the site as we have observed the site on our site visit.
And it's an 84-acre.
Next. Yeah. And then, you know, then you go down to the next benefit. Can the benefit be sought? This is one that you know, you don't have to give much of an answer to, but can the benefit sought by the applicant be achieved by some other method feasible for the applicant to pursue? Very frequently, a variance is the only option.
Right, because it has, the structure has to be put in that place, given the topography and that kind of thing.
So I would say to this question, I'd say is, the board's reviewed this matter, and we think a variance is the only feasible option for the property owner.
All right, but, okay. John, I'm now becoming a secretary, and I can't participate as a board member. I was on the Morton Library Board for a few years, and that became they would not hire a secretary. Mm-hmm. So I was taking notes and trying to make everything correct, and I was not weighing the issues of the Morton Library in a way that I should. That's why I was there, I thought.
But I think we can give you the information you need, or any board member needs, after we close the public hearing, we discuss where we're going to go on this, and address this.
We walk through these and give whoever's writing it the words. Maybe, you know, the question to be decided now is, for this one case here, you've presented it the way it is, do we either just say, okay, we'll vote on this one now as it is and accept it, because this one doesn't have to be perfect. No one showed up at the public hearing. No one argued against this.
We've already approved it once. Yep. It just lapsed by time.
This one isn't going to in Article 78, probably, right? So we could just say, all right, we'll learn from it, and the next time we'll like when you.
I think that probably represents
the next one,
right. A reasonable way to proceed.
We'll make sure we talk about ABCD.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I feel comfortable with that, especially given the fact we went through this once, 2 years ago, yeah, and approved everything they want. You know.
Yeah. So we'll the ones that go forward, we'll process a little differently.
All right.
And we'll help out whoever's writing it. So at this point, do you want to make a motion?
All right, I'll make a motion to accept this resolution.
Sorry, Mr.
Just one tad bit of a thing. Under the referrals and responses, this application was also sent to the town of Redwood.
No one appeared. You see, they had an opportunity to come. The meeting was open.
No, what I was saying is, there was actually no referral.
It wasn't a referral, but you notified them?
Didn't we notify them?
They were provided notice of the public hearing.
Yes, personal notice.
This actually says an application. So when I spoke to Kim the other day, she had mentioned something about just changing the verbiage, that it's a public hearing notice, but it's in the public hearing area. So.
Well, it actually probably belongs in paragraph 13.
It is there.
Well, it's in 12 right now under the referral and responses, but there is a public hearing paragraph.
Yes. Number 14 mentions that.
What's that?
Right. It was sent on the 19th.
Yes. So number 14 mentions that the public hearing notice was sent to the town of Redwood.
Yep.
So,
and that's sufficient.
Yes.
So the other can come right out.
That's my question.
Okay. Chris, I'll give this back to you, and you can cross it out. Good.
Okay, so Richard made a motion to
accept that.
I second it.
Second it.
Yeah. I second it with the changes that we've discussed.
Good.
Okay. Any more discussion?
Nope.
No? Okay, once she gets done, you hold the board.
So I pull the board, Tim Allen.
In favor?
Aye.
Yes.
Aye. Richard? Scott?
Yes.
Jeff?
Yes.
Yes.
And David?
Yes.
Okay. All right, we made it through our first one. Good job.
Jeff, I want to particularly thank you.
Hey, it's the best resolution we've ever written.
It is.
There you go, Jeff.
Now it is.
Now you're talking.
Except for the recent one on Red Wing.
Yes, okay. And the Williams one, and the Duffy one, and the Gun Club. And, but those are special things. Anyway, yes. All right. Now we got through that. All right, we have discussion on the Ruby's application.
Actually, you don't require any discussion, so.
Well, yeah, the public hearing was, continued over. Do we continue it over another 60 days pursuant to the request of the applicant?
Can be continued over to a date to be determined. I don't know. where this is going.
Right.
The part of it that's outside of our box. John Marvin, who's the lawyer for the applicant, asked that the matter be tabled.
Right, he wrote a letter to that effect.
Yep, and they're exploring some other options. So I would just say that the action that you can take tonight is to...
extend the public hearing?
Extend the public hearing to
for a date to be determined.
Not yet to be determined until the applicant contacts us about their readiness to continue the process.
Right, do we need a motion on that?
Be a good idea.
I'll make that motion.
All right, I'll second it. All in favor?
Aye.
Against? All right. So hopefully they'll take care of that. All right. Next is Michael Gregory, and that's the resolution I did this afternoon.
And I'm recused.
And you're recused, so. You have a draft in front of you. I will warn you in advance.
It's only going to be the second best resolution.
Anyway.
So, you know, if we look, the template was something that was supposed to make life easier.
It will.
I do want you to try it out and give it a few laps around the track, but just so that you know, my mind is open. If you know, if it's something that just ends up not working, we can investigate other ways to.
No. I myself like it. I think it's good. We just had to get it on the system, and then try to fill it in. And there's some growing pains, but that's okay. So
I think I just whatever we do, you guys just need to get in the habit of being familiar with the steps that you need to take, and sort of, you know, it's like. Pitching in baseball or chefing, the key is being able to repeat quality delivery time after time.
Yeah. All right, so let me give it a whirl again, folks. It's pretty rough, but this is the resolution of the Town of Rhinebeck Zoning Board of Appeals in the matter of Michael Gregory, case number 944. Applicant is Michael Gregory, and appellant should be taken out. And there's going to be a lot of that.
That's okay.
Applicant is Michael Gregory. I guess referred herein as applicant. The appeal is from the Town of Rhinebeck. Building inspectors.
CEO.
Denial. Dated December 20th, 2016. And that's going to be kind of a problematic thing later on. We'll get to that.
Okay.
The appeal involves property located at 254 Route 308 in the Town of Rhinebeck, bearing tax parcel blah, blah, blah. It's in the RC5 zoning district. The applicant was represented by surveyor Kevin Young. Description of the proposed project. The applicant's project is described as follows: a proposed art studio. There should be more added to that. I put a proposed art studio addition to an existing garage. That's more accurate. And Chris, I'll send over the changes tomorrow because there's a lot of them. Okay. The area variance 1 and variance 2 were not done correctly, but anyway, the first area variance sought by the applicant is a rear yard setback variance from section 125-20 and 21, requiring a 50-foot setback period. These are all things that I wrote in. The proposed studio is 19 feet from the rear property line, requiring a 31-foot variance. Similarly, I had to backfill variance 2, and the proposal I'm reading is the second area variance sought by the applicant is a side yard setback variance from the same section, requiring a 50-yard setback. The proposed studio is 10 feet from the side property line, requiring a 40-foot variance. So that's the fill-in for those two things. Here's where I have a quandary. Timeliness of the appeal. The applicant filed an appeal with this board on December 12, 2016, and that's according to the stamp on the application. Has paid the requisite fee. Appeal was filed within 60 days of the date of the ZEO's decision appealed from, and thus the application is timely. However, they actually filed the application 8 days before the denial letter.
Yeah, so they're timely. They're early.
They're early.
They're early.
So, or clairvoyant or something or other. But
lateness,
anyway.
Lateness is the only thing we care
so
about.
So it's weird, but
I think it's going to be something, you know, that's just given the way that the denial letters come out. It's going to repeat itself. Yeah. I wouldn't worry about
I'm not,
it.
I'm not worried about it. It's just, it's bizarre. Okay, on January 4th, the board deemed the application to be complete and accepted it. Seeker, we did a seeker determination, and we said that it was a type 2 section cited was 16.5C12. Then after that, on the second page, the first half has to be taken out entirely. It was just rewritten the things we have to choose from. Paragraph 11, referrals and responses. This has to be changed to Dutchess County Planning, and then I got rid of the rest of that sentence. I just tied it into the section underneath it where it says Dutchess County Planning Department determined that the application was exempt from review, which was confirmed by the Dutchess County Department of Planning and Development by notice of exemption dated January 10th, 2017. We got a written notice from them saying it was exempt. Town of Rhinebeck Planning Board, as required, it was referred over to them, and the town planning board responded on January 11th, stating that the requested area variances raised no significant planning or environmental issues. CAB did not have to be, no referral had to be done because it's not a use in development of open space. Similarly, the Waterfront Advisory Committee didn't have to be referred to because it doesn't, the property doesn't lie within the town's coastal area. And so that's that. I don't know if the board members had an opportunity to go out and site visit. I did. So okay. If anybody else did, let me know and I can include them. I went out on January 28th, 2017 and looked it over.
Yeah, and you know, that brings up a good point, Scott, that we may want to change the template to, I mean, you can make notes of the day of your site visit in your own notes in case we ever need them someday, but it's probably easier to have this section not refer to a date and okay. Just say that the board members, you know, at least one board member went okay. And visited the site.
I'll change that.
And that way, then, as long as there's a site visit, you don't really have to make a change to the paragraph.
Okay, that's the way I'll do it. Public hearing was on January 18th. We closed the public hearing on the same date. And here's where I didn't do a whole lot more, but on the consideration of the five factors, will there be an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood? I said we feel the answer is no. The requested addition is not significant in comparison. Should be two. The other structures on the property, including, and I added, existing garage, which is going to be attached to, existing house, and the size of the lot. Can this be achieved by some other method? I said no. The addition requested appears to be the only solution to the applicant's, probably wrong word, problem. Really what I meant to say was, given the lot topography, you could only put it on that side of the garage. There's no room on the other side, and the two houses share a common driveway and all that kind of stuff. So I'll rework the word problem. I think a different word could be used there. Anyway, is the area variance substantial? I said no. Again, I used the words from A. The requested addition is not significant in size and is not significant in comparison with the existing garage, house, and lot size.
That's actually perfect because that actually is grasping there are two aspects to substantiality. Sometimes substantiality can be felt in an arithmetic sense. simply measuring, you know, what's allowed versus what's being requested.
Like a 10-foot variance out of 200 feet.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. But the courts also say that substantiality has to be looked at, too, in connection with the overall impact of the variance in the surrounding area. Mm-hmm. And you were able to capture both sides of theirs. And in the court cases, what they say is there are times they recognize when a variance that's arithmetically substantial is not substantial when viewed in its greater context. So it's good that you were able to look at both pieces.
It's actually a huge lot, and I have to make reference to the size of it at the beginning. Because it is, it's an enormous, it's a big lot. And then D, will there be an adverse impact on physical or environmental conditions in the neighborhood? I said no. The addition will not have an adverse impact on the neighborhood or change the nature of the neighborhood. Also, no neighbors objected to the requested variance. Right next door is Adam Geis's property, and if he had a problem, I'm sure he would have been here. So,
yep.
This I probably got wrong, and maybe, you know, I said was the difficulty self-created. I said no, and the reason I said no was just because they couldn't put it anywhere else. But I guess it could be yes, because if they wanted to build it, you know, it's self-imposed. I'm not sure how to interpret the question.
It's the latter.
Okay,
it's
so go for yes.
Yep.
All right. And do I have to say anything more than that? Just say yes and leave it alone?
A self-created hardship is one of those that you probably, in a lot of cases, you can, you know, yes, and one sentence is enough to explain it.
Okay.
In other words, if the zoning law restriction is in effect, and then you come in and you're asking for relief from that, I mean, the fact that you're coming in and asking for relief means that, you know, your hardship is self-created because the restriction existed before you came in and made your request.
Okay. So I'll just change that to yes. And then I said, as a result of our analysis, based on the analysis of the five factors discussed, there's a typo there. The D has to be taken out. Above, we find that the balancing test favors granting the area variance is sought. Then I just went through, now therefore be it resolved. We grant the variances from zoning law section 125.20 and 125.21, subject to the conditions stated below. That's just terminology from the template. This grant shall allow a variance from rear yard setback of 50 feet to 19 feet for a total variance of 31. Same thing on the second, saying that the grant shall allow reduction in the side yard setback on the west side of the property from the required 50 to 10 for a variance of 40. There was a section 3 I took out. The granting of the variances are expressly contingent upon, it's not contingent upon anything. Section 4 we already discussed. I just took it out. And then 5 and 6 are boilerplate, saying that, you know, they have to secure whatever other approvals are needed, and it's null and void after a year if they haven't, you know, commenced construction within that time frame. So anyway, with all those massive changes, do I have any other questions, concerns, changes?
Second best variance ever written.
It's not even close. Yeah, I understand. Anyway.
It's better than all the other ones we wrote before this.
Thanks. Anyway, any constructive criticism?
I think it's good.
All right. All right, so if there's no other changes, comments, or concerns, I make the motion that we adopt the resolution.
As amended,
and I'll submit the amended resolution tomorrow to Chris.
I'll second it.
Okay. Chris, can you do your magic?
We don't have to do it all in favor, thing?
No, we have to do that.
Okay.
You have to poll the board.
Okay. All right, that's a point. All right. Poll the board. Tim?
Yes.
Richard?
Yes.
Scott?
Yes.
Jeff?
Yes.
Dave?
All right. Okay.
That's good. So can you bear one more suggestion about the...
Sure.
...the template? So the other reason it's seeming very hard right now is because you have to... We're trying to implement the template with several applications that are midstream. Mm-hmm. But the other idea behind doing it, who's doing EverReady? Is that you, Dave?
I am. No.
Oh,
no, Richard.
You are. Okay. So the idea is that sometime after tonight's meeting, you take the EverReady materials that Chris gave you, and you should be able to go through and already start your decision by, you can probably almost do all of page one.
Yes.
Okay. And then you leave that. And then at the next meeting, when the public hearing happens, at the end of the public hearing, you're able to do the next chunk of it. And the idea is that by the time that it comes to write the decision, all you really have to do is that section on the
right.
decision.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay.
Yep.
And we're going to also give you better language. So the other thing that is not sufficient for my tastes is the criteria for the balancing test is there, but I want to actually state the balancing test, which is you're balancing whether the granting of the benefit to the applicant by granting the variance is outweighed by the detriment to the surrounding neighborhood if the variance is granted. So we're just going to say that to just always keep the test itself in your minds.
Okay, great.
As we shoot for an A plus on
yes.
every...
As I share my respect for my brother, I share
everyone, we're almost yep. done. You may join us if you wish. Okay, the last thing is the... notice of intent that we received from the planning board seeking to be lead agency under SECRE with regard to Astor Courts. So, John, is there anything? I mean, I have no quarrel with that.
You don't have any desire to do the
none.
Be the lead agency
none,
for the
none
SECRE
whatsoever.
Review of that action. Then you can direct Chris to communicate to the planning board that you decline to act as lead agency.
Is that under SECRE?
Hmm?
Is that, you mean under
yeah.
SECRE?
Yes, yep.
Yeah. So do we have to respond to this? It's probably better
I think
practice.
It would be a good...
Right, so
because if the
30-day
periods
consent.
Don't always mesh, it lets them move forward.
Yeah. So do we need a motion or anything, or just tell them that we consent to
you,
their...
Why don't you have a motion to decline?
Okay. All right. With regard to this notice to intent by the planning board to be lead agency under SECRE for Astor Courts, I make a motion that we... consent to their desire to be lead agency. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Good. So, Chrissy, if you can just compose a quick letter and then I guess just run it by John. I don't even know if John, if you really need to see it, but.
Seems pretty benign.
Yeah, pretty benign. Just go for it.
Send that out.
It can be done in an email to Art and. Gretchen.
Okay, and I think that does
and
it.
And Michael, do you have Michael's email?
Mr. Kimball?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, the only other piece of correspondence was this, we've talked about it already, was the letter from John Marvin saying that they're going to be looking at some other ways to deal with the problem with the Ruggie's application, and he asked that we put it on hold for 60 days.
We talked about that, didn't we?
Yeah, but it's
yep.
on the end of the correspondence oh, yeah. here, so okay. just following the
agenda.
So yeah. I have one more thing to say before the end of the meeting, which is that we haven't, Chris and Kim and I are supposed to meet, you know, and we're going to continue to try to, you know, share ideas and sort of help Chris out, and we need to also understand, you know, the logistics of what she's dealing with. But, you know, speaking for Kim, who's not here tonight, we think she's doing a terrific job. The information that we're getting is really helpful to us, and for example, those packets that you're getting every, you know, for every meeting are great, and she's doing a great follow-up on you know, all the bits and pieces that have to be done behind the curtain for you guys in between meetings. So I just want you to know, I mean, we're working with her on a day-to-day basis, so I just want you guys to know that.
I appreciate
it. I'm joining that, absolutely. I think Jeff would too. We've been through a lot of very good clerks, but you're doing a fantastic job. Now, and you've learned really
it's
quickly.
It's not an easy job to just step into. So,
which was only, what, 2 months ago? Maybe less than that. So, fantastic.
Thank you.
Just don't go anywhere.
Yes,
stay with us.
Right.
Good. All right. I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Stay by yourself. All right, we're adjourned.